Hey guys, welcome to our training Python programming or scripting and AWS automation with Python. So let me discuss first what is our agenda for our course, for our demo. See, our today's agenda, I mean for demo or agenda is what is Python and its features and what can we do with Python and what are the different versions are there in Python. Then what is automation, why it is required, how automation can be achieved, then for automation why Python only, then who uses Python, then what is AWS automation, then finally we'll discuss some demo scripts. After that I will show what are the syllabus I'm going to cover for this course. At any time if you have any queries you can ask me. Okay, without any delay let me start our first concept. What is Python? See, basically Python is a general purpose programming language. So general purpose, so it is not for any specific purpose, it is a general purpose programming language. That's why you can use it in anywhere in real time. Where we can use this Python, I will show that. And basically it was created by Guido van Rossum in 1980s. See, Python is also called as high level language because if you know like C, Java, all are high level languages because they are using English words, that's it simply. So Python also is straightforward, it is also using English words only. Then interpreted language. See, in any language, if it may be Python or C or Java, there has to follow any one of the conversion techniques like either interpreter or compiler. Then what is the difference between interpreted language and compiling language? Nothing is there, it's very simple. See, in suppose let me take first compiled language. Suppose if you take C, C is compiled language. In that, suppose let me assume if we are having some 7 lines or 6 lines of code in C, then whenever if you are running this program, if it is C language, then this entire 7 lines of code will be compiled, will be converted into your machine level language at a time. And in case, just assume in second line and somewhere in fifth line there are some errors, then compiler will give at a time these two errors. There is an error at 2 and 2nd and 5th line. Whereas in interpreter, just assume same lines of code are there in suppose Python. So Python comes under interpreter language. Same way assume here also there is an error in 2nd line and 5th line. Now whenever if you run this code using Python, Python interpreter, it won't convert all lines at a time to your machine language. It will go and convert line by line. First it will go and check with first line. If there is no error, then it will convert second line also. In case if there is any error second line, your program will be stopped there itself and at output side it will give there is some error at second line. Once if you correct that error, then and again if you run, again it will start from first line. If there is no error in first line, it will go to second line. And again if there is no error in second line, it will go to third line. If there is no error, it will go to fourth line. If there is no error, then it will go to fifth line. In case if there is an error in fifth line, then again your program will stop there. And it will say that there is an error at fifth line. So that is the only difference between compiled language and interpreter language. So in compiled language simply it will give, in case if there are multiple errors in your programming, then it will give all the errors at a time. But in interpreted language it won't give like that. It will go and check with line by line. In case if you have any error at any particular line, then your program will stop there itself and it will give what is the error there. So that is the only difference between interpreter and compiled language. Now, then what is the advantage with compiled and interpreter language? So there is an advantage as well as there is a disadvantage also. Advantage is you can run your program even in command line also, line by line. If you take C programming language, you can't run your programming language on command line, line by line. You have to run your entire program at a time. But in interpreted language, a simple interpreted language, you must know or write. Suppose if you take shell or bash, or if you take your Windows command line batch, all are interpreted language. Suppose if you take a Linux command, ls is a command, but basically ls is also one of the shell script. You are running ls, suppose. So that command is running. Single command, suppose. After that, suppose even in Linux commands also, you can write, suppose, some x equals to 5. In second line, you can also write echo dollar x. So those two lines are in different lines, but still you are getting your output. So that means simply in interpreted language, you can execute your lines of code one by one, so that you can check what is the output in first line, what is the output in second line, is it helpful for me in next line. In case if there is any error, you can get it. That is an advantage. But disadvantage is, compared to compiled languages, interpreted languages, operations are very less. But of course, for automation, using scripting concept, automation, that is not a drawback. Then Python is also called as scripting language. This is very, very important. What is scripting language? Basically, Python is a programming language, but it is also called as scripting language. Then what is the terminology, difference between these two terminologies, programming and scripting? Basically, all languages are programming languages. But some of the languages, they are allowed to communicate with your other programming languages. Let me take simple example. Just assume, suppose your Linux operating system. So Linux OS is, suppose, it is built with, suppose, C. C is a programming language. So on Linux command lines, suppose you are running ls command. So that it is giving on your operating system, suppose what are the directories or files are there. So here ls command is communicating with your operating system. That's why whatever the code you are written using commands in Linux, you are calling as shell script. Script is nothing but whatever the programming you are writing, that program will able to communicate with other programming language. So here ls command is communicating with other programming language, that other programming language is operating system. Basically, operating system is built with, suppose, C. C is a programming language. But C can't, using C programming, you can't list your files, because C is not supporting scripting concept. But here, suppose shell scripting is able to communicate with your operating system, so that because of ls command, you are getting what are the files and directories are there on your operating system. So simply, scripting language is nothing but, it is a programming language basically, but that is also designed for interacting and communicating with your other programming languages. That other programming language may be operating system, or suppose in your environment, if you are working with, suppose, like middleware, WebLogic or WebSphere or Apache or Tomcat, through your scripting language, still you can able to communicate with middleware products also from command line. So that is an advantage with scripting language. Basically, remember that basically each and every programming language, each language is basically a programming language only. But some languages, they are come up with some extra feature that is nothing but scripting concept. So it is there with Python also. That's why Python is also called as scripting language, but basically it is a programming language. You need to remember that. One of the advantage in Python is scripting concept. That's it. See, some of the mostly used scripting language other than the Python, or along with Python, JavaScript, VBScript, PHP, Perl, Ruby, Python, some others like Swift. Swift is also supposed it is also supporting for scripting concept. Then our next concept in our agenda is features of Python. See, free and open source. Python is a free and open source, means you can download directly without having any license. No need to have license to install your Python software on your host. It is a free and open source. See, generally open source means you can see the source code of any software. Even in Python also you can see your source code, and in case if you want to change it, you can change that source code also, like how Linux operating systems are using by the organizations. So basically they will take Linux operating system, and because Linux is also open source, that's why based on their requirement, I mean organization requirement, they can also change the kernel operations. So likewise even in Python also you can change the source code. So that's why it is open source. Then easy to learn. See, compared to other programming languages, the syntaxes. See, before going to tell about syntax, in case if you don't know any concept about programming language, then syntaxes are simply a grammatical rule. Suppose if you consider here we are communicating with English. So in order to get information correctly, I mean whatever I am delivering, if you want to get that information, then I should follow the grammatical rules. Then only you can understand what I am teaching here. So same way in programming languages, that grammatical rules are nothing but syntaxes. So I mean while writing your programming, you need to follow some grammatical rules. Where you need to place is, when you need to place are, like that. There are different syntaxes are there. So that syntaxes are very easy in Python. Then that's why they are having very simple syntaxes. That's why it is very easy to learn. Then code length is very short. See, compared to other programming languages, let me take in case if you know C, like C programming language. In C programming language, if you want to write very very simple program, is suppose hello world. Print hello world. If you want to print simply hello world in C, you need to start with hash include stdio.h, then main function. Under that you need to write print hello world. So it is taking 3 lines of code. But when you come to Python, directly you can write print hello world, single line. So likewise, compared to other programming languages, the code length is very short in Python. So that is also one of the advantage or feature of our Python. Then platform independent. So that means you can run same programming, same script on any operating system. It may be Windows, it may be Linux, it may be Unix, or it may be Apple iOS. So on any operating system you can run same script. Just assume that you are writing code on Windows using Python programming, that same script you can also run on other operating systems. So that's why it is platform independent. So you know guys, right, Linux. So using Linux commands, if you write a script, that is shell script, it will work only on Linux operating systems or like Unix operating system. It won't work on Windows operating system. So that's why shell scripting is not platform independent. Even bash script, I mean whatever the script or PowerShell, if you write on Windows operating system, that will work only for Windows. It's not work for Unix like operating systems. So they are not platform independent, but Python is platform independent. So that is an advantage, right? And it supports both procedure oriented and object oriented concepts. So here procedure oriented means like functions concept. So it is there with C. And object oriented, OOPS concept, it is there with Java. So both two features are there here. So in case if you don't know about procedure oriented and object oriented, you don't worry. In our classes, we will discuss all those things. But this is also one of the advantages by using procedure oriented and object oriented. And lots of third party modules are available. So basically we know that if any software is open source, so for that support is there. I mean more support is there, right? So same way Python is open source, that's why there are more third party modules are available. So what is this third party module? It's nothing there. It is also one of the Python programming, but it is already developed by other one, by some others. Let's assume that, in case if you are aware of with some other databases, or in case your AWS, let's assume this is your Python code. This is suppose your AWS console. So from your Python code to connect with your AWS, you need to start write code from scratch. How to connect with the AWS, how to provide your credentials to your AWS account, everything you need to write code. But no need to write that. Already, in order to communicate with your AWS, some others already developed GoTo 3 Python script. But actually that is called module. Basically, it is also one of the program of Python. So again, in order to again no need to write code from scratch. So simply how to connect with your AWS, how to manage your AWS services. For that, you no need to write code from scratch. Just use this GoTo 3 module. Actually, this is also a Python program, but it's already developed by some others, some third party. So simply use this GoTo 3 in your program and do whatever the code you want to implement on your AWS console. So that means already some APIs are already developed. And there are so many third party modules, so many APIs, so many libraries, so many already developed Python programs are there in Python. So simply just use them so that your work will be reduced. So in Python, as of now, we are having 120,000 modules are there. So that you can do any work in real time using these all third party modules. In case if you are working on database side, just use database module, suppose MSQLD. Okay, if you are working with suppose some web scraping concept side, just use Beautiful Soap or URLLib. I mean, there are already modules are there, just use them. So here, once if you know how to use some modules based on your where you are, in case if you are database admin or AWS admin or a WebLogic admin or Linux admin, based on your domain side, what are the modules are there for my domain and how to use that modules in Python. If you know that concept, then you are a good programmer in Python. Okay, and one of the most important point you need to remember is, if you observe in any Unix operating system, any Unix like operating system, it may be iOS or Unix or Linux, MintOS or Ubuntu, they all are come up with default Python software. It may be 2.7 dot something. So already all Unix like operating systems are coming with that one of the default Python software. So that's why you no need to install your Python software on Unix like operating systems. Already there is a software. See, generally if you want to use any software, we need to install that. But in Unix operating system, there is a default Python software is there. So you no need to install. And there is no compatibility issues also. Because you are, so whenever if you are installing some software, you need to check some prerequisites. But here already Python is there with Unix operating system. Then you no need to worry about what are the requirements, how is there any compatibility issues while installing. You know, you don't think about that, right? So anyway, in productions, we know that in real time, most of the operating systems are suppose Unix-like operating system, and they are come up with Python software. That's why it is popular nowadays. And one more point is, after almost 1 year or 2 years, in IT field, each and everyone must know about Python, at least basics. Okay, now using Python, what can we do? See guys, because of third party modules, because of help with community, open source modules, we can use Python in different areas. See, using Python, you can develop web applications. To develop web applications, there are already modules are there like Django, Flask. Using those two modules, you can easily develop web applications. Then, nowadays, you know that artificial intelligence is trending one, right? Hot topic. So even in AI, Python is extensively they are using. But to understand about AI, how to use Python, there are some specific modules are there. Just learn about them so that you can use Python in artificial intelligence. Then you can also use Python in testing. So in order to do automation of Python, you can use Python in testing with the help of Selenium module. Basically, Selenium is a tool, right? Same module is there with your Python, so that you can do a testing with the help of Python. Then web scraping. So web scraping is nothing but getting some data from websites based on URL. If you provide some URL, so that you can get information from that URL without opening your browser. So that's concept is web scraping. Then data analysis. So even in data analysis also Python is used with the help of some NumPy, SciPy, Pandas. There are some modules are there. So using those modules, you can do data analysis as well as data analytics. Guys, data analysis as well as data analytics, both are different. Data analysis means, see, suppose in your organization, as of now, otherwise, if I give some 1 GB of data from last 1 year, whatever the data I collected, and from that data, what happened? That is data analysis. And based on that data, what is going to happen? That is data analytics. You need to remember that. And in both the concept, data analysis as well as data analytics, Python is using. Then you can also use in gaming apps and some GUI applications. And finally, in automation. And here, from my institute, we are going to cover these concepts as of now: automation, web scraping, and data analysis. Okay, anyway, these are some of the areas where we can use Python extensively. Okay, then see different versions of Python. Basically, there are three types of versions in Python: 1.x, 2.x, and 3.x. Anyway, 1.x is outdated. Now we are having two versions, 2.x and 3.x. See, in 2.x, the latest version is 2.7.14, and whereas in 3.x, latest version is 3.6.4. And nowadays, the most confusing concept is which version I need to learn, either 2.x or 3.x. It's not a problem. You can learn either 2.x and 3.x. The only difference between 2.x and 3.x is there are around some 10 to 12 syntaxes or differ in 2.x and 3.x. Once if you learn either 2.x or 3.x, you must know what is the difference between some of the syntaxes within 2.x as well as 3.x. Then only you are more comfortable to work with either 2.x and 3.x. Because guys, 2.x support will be there up to 2020, and development also will be there up to 2020. After 2020, they are not going to develop any versions in 2.x. Up to now, most of the organizations, up to 70% of the organizations, they are using 2.x. because, see, compared to 3.x, anyway 2.x is older version. Because of that, there is a more support from third party libraries in 2.x. see, as of now 120,000 third party modules are there with 2.x, not with 3.x. In 3.x only up to 35,000 modules are there. So I mean, you can't effectively use 3.x in all areas, but you can use 2.x effectively in all areas. But anyway, in automation it's not a problem to use 2.x as well as 3.x, because basically Python is essentially used for automation. That's why already third party modules are developed in 2.x and 3.x in order to do automation. Okay, but nowadays you need to remember that most of the organizations, up to 70% of the organizations, they are using 2.x. After 2020 they will move to 3.x. Okay, see, after 2020 they are going to stop development in 2.x, but software will be there. Even if you want to use 2.x, you can use 2.x. So that's it. Again, in 3.x, 3.7 is also in development mode. Okay, so that is a very simple discussion about Python. Then, so in our course, basically we are using Python in automation. Okay, so before going to discuss about in course wise, before going to discuss about automation, first 30 hours of course will be on Python, so that anyone can use Python based on their requirement. So it is not regarding with automation, or it is not regarding with web scraping, or it is not regarding with data analysis. First 30 hours based on purely Python programming. So there I will cover complete Python, how to use Python in different areas, so that you will get some idea. So after that, AWS automation is one of the automation in Python. So next 20 hours, basically our complete course is 50 hours, 30 hours for purely for Python programming and scripting concept, then remaining 20 hours for AWS automation. Okay, but mainly we will focus on automation with Python. But anyway, I will give complete idea where we can use Python, how to use in different areas. Now coming to automation with Python, so first of all we must know what is automation. Anyway, most of the guys knows about automation, right? So simply, automation is a process in which, by which we can complete any task with less human intervention or without human intervention. See, simply, in case I think Apache web server, I think it is known to everyone, right? Or any application. See, if you want to start Apache web server, you need to go to, suppose where HTTP file is there, you need to move to that path, and there you need to start, you have to provide your command to start your Apache web server. So that is suppose manual process. So instead of that, if you write some script, guys, script is nothing but a programming only, but whenever if you are communicating with other programming language using your programming, then that time your programming is also called as script. That's it. Okay, anyway, in order to start your Apache web server, you need to go to where HTTP file is there, and there you have to provide your HTTP-K some start command. So instead of going to that path and instead of giving that command, if you write a simple script, okay, then by running with single step, just run your script, so that your script will able to move to the particular location and it will grab your command and it will start. So now here we are doing automation, because we are starting your Apache web server through the script with a single step. So here manual intervention is required. But instead of that, suppose if you have a script to start your Apache web server, and if you schedule cron job, okay, if you schedule cron job, then in that time, so automatically based on your time, when it has to start and when it has to stop, automatically it will do. So in that case, no need of manual intervention. Okay, so that is nothing but when manual intervention is required, and without manual intervention, how we can do. Okay, and when we go with automation, So generally, we will go with automation whenever there is a repetitive task. See, suppose if you are a Linux admin guy, in order to apply patches, there are some steps, right? So generally, patching is repeated task, right? Weekly once or monthly once, based on your organization, based on their how they are feeling about security. Based on that, generally they will apply patches, right? So anyway, to apply patches, you require some steps. So whenever if you want to apply patch, you need to follow all steps. So instead of following your all steps, anyway, that is repeated task, then go and place all steps in some script and simply execute your script in a single step so that your script will execute all your scripts. So that is like automation. So generally we will go with automation whenever there is a repetitive task. That's it. Then see why this automation is required. First and foremost thing is to improve productivity. See, let us assume your patching concept only. If you are having some 10 Linux boxes, if you want to apply patches manually on each server, on each box, okay, just assume 10 minutes, it's not 10 minutes, just assume it is taking 10 minutes. Now, to apply, suppose on 10 servers, it will take, let us assume 6 servers, anyway, it's best 10 minutes, 6 servers are there. To do your patching on suppose 6 servers, each server will take 10 minutes, then on 6 servers, it will take suppose 1 hour, 60 minutes. So instead of that, suppose if you are having a script, just run each script on each server with single step. See, just run this script on this first server with single step, and you don't need to concentrate on remaining steps because script will automatically run. Then go to second server and there run your script. Go to third server and there run your script. So all over, if you observe, it will reduce your time 1 hour to suppose some 6 minutes. Just assume to run your script on each server, it will take 1 minute. Then on 6 servers, it will take 6 minutes only. So instead of 1 hour, instead of 60 minutes, it will take 6 minutes. So that means within 6 minutes, you are applying all patches to all servers. So that means you are improving your productivity. So that is an advantage for our organizations, not for us, right? So anyway, we have to serve for them. So they will require automation skills nowadays. So we need to learn automation. That's it. Then, accuracy in data handling. See, manually, whenever if you are doing a task, there is a chance to give some wrong command. But it is not, of course, 90% we won't give wrong commands. But sometimes, while entering, there may be a typo error. Okay. So, while doing manually, there is a chance to give some wrong command. But when you write all steps in script, and if you do testing, once if it is good, right, then it will never do mistake. So there is an accuracy in data while handling with your script. So that is also advantage. Then finally, to reduce employee power. So again, this is not an advantage for us. It is an advantage for an organization only. But of course, we need to learn. Then see, finally, it is better, faster, and based on reducing employee power, it is cheaper. So these 3 points are important. Because of these 3 points, automation is implemented. That's it. Then see how automation can be achieved. So the only thing is scripting language. See, why we are calling scripting language instead of programming language? Already I have given that. Scripting language only can able to communicate with other programming languages. So your operating system also one of the programming language, or if you are having any applications, they are also one of the programming language. So automation nothing but, you know, you should communicate with any one of the programming language, apps or operating system, whatever it may be. Okay, that's why whatever the code you are using to implement your automation, that is called scripting language. So basically there is no difference between scripting and programming. All languages are programming languages, but some of them, they are also supporting for scripting. That's it. Anyway, now we know that automation can be implemented by using scripting languages only. So there are so many scripting languages are there based on where they are using automation. Perl, Java, VB, Apple Script, Shell Script, Golang, and Python Script. Okay. So basically, you can use instead of Python, you can also use Shell Script. But the disadvantage with Shell Script is you can use Shell Script only on Unix-like operating system. You can't use that Windows operating system. So I can say this is the best example why we are selecting Python. Okay. Along with that, there are some features. That's why we are using Python scripting for automation. See, whenever if you implement your script for your automation, definitely you need to run manually your script. At least one step is required to run your script. Manually you need to run. Okay. Other than your scripting language, if you are having some tools, then automatically you can run your script based on your required time, at what time you want to run your script. Guys, try to understand this. See, if you are having a script, assume that there are some 5 steps for particular task. Instead of doing 5 tasks manually, you are writing a script. And anyway, to run this script, at least you need to run one step manually. That is nothing but to run your script. Okay. So even though if you are having scripting language, manual intervention is required to run your script, but script will do your action. Now, instead of this, even instead of one step, to run manually, if you are having some tools, like cron job is also a one tool. You can schedule your time. Based on that time, it will run your script. Or if you know HPSA, or Ansible, Chef, Puppet. So based on that tools also, suppose if you take HPSA, Ansible, Chef, Puppet, at a time you can run your script on different servers. Anyway, all those are configuration management tools. You can run your script on different servers at a time. So along with your scripting, to do your automation effectively, you should also know automation tools also. Anyway, nowadays DevOps is a trending one in automation side. Okay, but basically for automation you need one of the scripting language. So here we are going to cover Python as scripting language to do automation. See, so automation tool nothing but to trigger your script, to run your script. That's it. Now, why Python only means? First and foremost thing is it is a open source. Because of that, there are so many third party modules are there. Because of availability of third party modules, you no need to write code from scratch for each and every task. Already there is a code, you just use that code. How to use that in your Python, that is important. If you know that, then your task will be completed within less time. Okay. So because of so many third party modules availability, you can use Python anywhere in real time. So simply you can solve real world problems using Python. So suppose create games also you can create. Already we discussed that. Yes, I am giving that. And anyway, our important concept is here. Automate the tasks. That's it. See, some of the organizations who are using this Python nowadays, Google is using Python. So along with Python, Google is also using Golang. It is developed by themselves. So Go language is also a scripting language that is developed by Google. But as of now, there are no, more availability of third party modules are with Golang. So that's why still they are using Python. NASA is also using Python for their research purpose. Based on some requirement, these are some of the organizations where they are using Python language as a programming or as a scripting. If they want to do automation, they will use Python as a scripting language. If you want, they want to develop some web applications or web scraping, then they will use Python, suppose, as a programming language. That's it. So these are some of the organizations who are using effectively Python. See, then coming to AWS automation. See, you know, right, as a AWS admin, guys, you know what are the repetitive tasks. So all those tasks, instead of repeating, you can write a Python script such that you can automate your tasks. And coming to this AWS automation, you can automate AWS tasks in different ways. See, using shell script with AWS CLI commands. You know, right, AWS CLI commands are in order to do, I mean, it's like simply commands like a Linux operating system. Those AWS CLI commands are for AWS service. That's it. Once if you are good with, suppose, shell as well as AWS CLI commands, without going to Python, you can also automate using these two concepts. Just simply place your AWS CLI commands in shell script so that you can do your automation. And in case if you know AWS CLI commands and Python script, you can also do automation using AWS CLI commands and Python script. Nothing is there, just running your AWS CLI commands in Python. Then Python with Boto 3. So in case if you don't know AWS CLI commands, then there is a third party module, Boto 3. So the purpose of Boto 3 is, first of all, it is a third party module. So using that Boto 3 module, you can able to connect it to your AWS service from your local host without opening GUI, I mean browser, and without providing credentials. With the help of Boto 3, you can connect with your through command line, you connect with your AWS account. And whatever the action, if you want to do manually or in GUI mode on your AWS service, I mean AWS console, same things you can do with Boto 3. So for that purpose, already there is a programming is developed, and that developed program name is they are giving as Boto 3. But basically that Boto 3 is Python program. It is also called as module or library or package. Okay. So anyway, in our course, our main concentration is on Python with Boto 3. But of course, I will also discuss about these two, how to use in shell script and Python script this AWS CLI commands. In case if you are good with shell script, I will show how to use that. In case if you don't want to use Boto 3 in our organization, then I will show how to use AWS CLI commands in Python to do automation of your AWS. Okay, so after that we will also discuss about a Lambda, how to run your Python code in Lambda. That's it. So these are the things we can do automation in AWS. Okay, now see, I want to run some simple demo scripts I want to show. Nowadays we know, right, DevOps is a trending one. In DevOps we are using one of the tool Git as version control system. So to install Git, there are some steps. So you should have some prerequisites. You need to install some build tools. After that, you need to download your Git tarball. Then you need to install that tarball. So if you want to install, suppose, Git on different servers, on each and every server, you should go manually and you need to run your steps. So instead of that, if you have a, suppose, Python script, you can install, deploy, or you can install your Git on different servers. Let me show this simple script how to install Git on servers through script. See, if you see my script, then you will get some idea what is up. Sorry, I don't have any servers. Yeah, I have some. Let me start that. Having that script, no problem. See, suppose this is my script. This script will install Git automatically. The purpose of this script is, see, it will list all the updated versions of Git. I mean, suppose if you are having Git 2.3.8, then this script will show the, once if you run this script, after your version, what are the updated versions are there with Git. All those versions it will show. See, first of all, I will run this script. Let me check Git version. Okay, I don't have any Git as of now in my host. Let me run that script and observe that how it is working. See, I'm running that. So some prerequisites. So this is a Python script. You need some module, third party module. So after that, see, if you observe, the purpose of this script is it will find the existing Git version, if any. If it is any Git version was there already, it will show that. Otherwise, in case if already there, you will also use to update or install the latest Git. If you observe here on my screen, it is showing that Git is not installed as of now. Git is not installed. As of now, Git is not installed. Now it is asking that, do you want to install the Git on this host? See, if I give yes, instead of yes, if I give some spelling mistake, it is asking that enter only yes or no. So suppose I am giving yes, and these are the versions as of now. Git versions are there with Git. And if you observe, this is the latest Git version 2.9.5. And let me select any one of that. Suppose I am selecting, suppose 2.4.5, then it will install only 2.4.5. So automatically, no need to install this curl devil, right? These are the some packages, yum packages you need to install to support your Git version. So all those packages will be installed automatically. So for that, I have written a code in Python code, I mean Python script. So it is installing that required yum packages first. So it will take some time. You can observe my screen. Meanwhile, if you have any queries, you can ask. Yeah, now it's going and installing our Git. See, whenever if you run this Git first time, it is displaying all the Git versions. Once if you install, suppose particular version, in case once if you install already, if there is a particular version, after that, after your version, what are the updated version, those versions only it will show. So even in our script itself, you can select such that I want only updated version. So just one line modification in code, so that automatically it will select the latest Git version and it will install that latest Git version if there is any latest versions. So all those things you can do in script. See here, actually, whatever the task is done by your script, it is displaying. Even you can hide this information also. So there are some different modules. To display your output, there is one module in Python. To hide your output, there is some different module in Python. Just based on that, which module you are going to use, based on that, your output will be displayed or it will be hide. That's it. See, it's completed as of now. And if you observe here, now your Git is installed, right? Sorry, now your Git is installed with version 2.4.5. Actually, we selected that. Even if you run on command line, see 2.4.5. Again, if you run same script once again, as of now you are having 2.4.5. Now it will display. Observe here. Now I ran that. See, previously it showed that there is no Git version. Now it is showed that currently installed Git version is 2.4.5. See, previously it is asking that do you want to install. Now it is asking that do you want to update the Git. Suppose yes. Then observe that from 2.4.5 these all are the updated versions. So even if you can display all versions also, but I have written code such that it has to display only updated versions. So that's why it is giving only updated versions. So you can also select, suppose, updated versions of 2.8.5. Now it will install. So anyway, it will install. Just now we saw that how it will work. So basically here concept is, we know that Git software is there with Git SCM website, right? Some Git So you need to go to this website, right? So here suppose downloads, and here I work with Linux suppose, and I have taken a tarball, that's why I went to there. So from this website, so this complete website, you can see all the updated versions. So this is our basic URL. From this URL you need to download first of all this entire concept, whatever the data is there, entire data. So from this data you need to filter tarballs, then you need to, I mean with the tar.gz, because if you observe here tar.xz is there, tar.sign, okay, different balls are there, but I filtered that such that I want to grep only tar.gz. So after grepping that, from this link I need to extract version, then I want to display that version, then I need to select particular version. Based on your selected version, what is the URL to download that tarball. So you need to form that tarball URL. From that you need to download it. Once if you download it, you need to extract it, right? Once if you extract it tarball, you know how to install any tarball. You need to configure it, you need to make it, you need to make install it, right? Finally, in case if you want to create any soft link after installing your tarball, you need to create that soft link also. So these all are the steps you need to perform manually. So without that, I have written a simply Python script. It will work everything. It will do your steps. So suppose this is one of the automation how to install Git. So even instead of selecting particular version, you can write code such that I want to select always only updated version. If there is any updated version, I need to install that updated version. Before that, I need to send some confirmation to my mail ID. You can configure everything. So that is like one of the simple automation code. So this is suppose other than AWS. Even in AWS, now I am on my local host. Okay. And if you observe in my AWS console, our server is supposing running state. Okay. And this region is suppose Virginia, means US East, right? Let me run my I'm having one code. See, so this is the code, Boto3 code, using Boto3 Python script. This will script, this script will start or stop your EC2 instance based on your instance ID and region, in which region you want to start or stop your instance. So you need to provide your region as well as your instance ID such that it will do your action. Let me run this script. Anyway, this is very simple script. I am running that script. Give me a second. D This script will help you to start or stop your instance based on your required region and instance ID. Enjoy by using this script. Just provide your region. Suppose I am providing US East 1. And it will display the, see, after giving your region name, anyway it will connect it to your AWS East 2 console, and it will display the number of instance IDs, whatever the instances are there in your particular region. So as of now, in my region, I'm having only one instance. That's why it is giving only single instance ID. Now see, now choose your instance ID to start or stop. Now I'm giving instance ID. Now enter either stop or start command for your EC2 instance. So suppose if I, instead of start, if I give some wrong command, then it will ask only enter stop or start command. That means you have to give exactly start or stop. By mistake, if you go any wrong word, then script has to take care. So in that way, you need to implement your code. And if you observe in console, as of now, our server is running. And again, if I give command as start, then what will happen? Start. So your instance is already running. In case if it is not running, then only it will run. Now, instead of that, so I'm again running same code. And I am providing my region. Now I am selecting my instance ID to start or stop. Now I want to give command as stop. See, please wait, it's going to stop. Once it is stopped, then we'll let you know. So everything will be based on our requirement. First, we will write our script. So whatever the script you have written, based on your script only, it will work. Now see, if you go to your console, if you refresh it, observe here, instead of running state, it is showing suppose starting, but it is not yet stopped completely. Once if it is stopped, then only your script will say that, it is stopped. So anyway, we know that it will take some time to stop. Even without getting confirmation whether it is stopped or start, I mean stopped of your EC2 instance, you can wind up your script. But I have written a script such that it will finalize the your status of your EC2 instance. So that's why it is waiting. So likewise, for each and every task on your AWS, you can implement your code. And anyway, after completion of our course, we will implement based on your requirement. We will do one mini project also. Okay guys, it's take yeah, it's stop, but why it's, sorry, let me run once again. Suppose this is my instance ID. Now I want to start it. Now refresh it and check it. Anyway, as of now it's in pending state. Okay, once if it is start, then we will come to skip and we will see that. So meanwhile, see, this is our course concept, I mean our course, what we are going to teach in our course. For that, this is the syllabus. If you want to, you can take a snapshot, I mean you can take a screenshot. So first we'll cover with Python programming or Python scripting concepts. So for that, these are the concepts we are going to cover. And based on your requirement, in case if you are a database admin or Linux admin or WebLogic admin, based on your requirement, I will go with the different modules. Here, basically in Python, you should know about modules. That is the main concept. Based on where you are working, your domain, I will cover different modules. But these are the standard modules I need to cover for each and everyone who wants to do automation. So once if it is done, then we will go with AWS automation. See, in AWS automation, we'll go with first AWS CLI. So anyway, I'm giving here very basics about AWS CLI, because our main concept is BOTO3, because that is Python. Then in BOTO3, we are having basically two types of methods to write your Python code. One is resource and one more is client. So I need to cover these two. Effectively, we will cover resource and client, how to use that. Then after that, I will also go with Lambda, how to write your Lambda, how to run your Python code from Lambda, and then how to triggers your Lambda. I mean, how to trigger your Lambda using different triggering methods. So guys, this is the course from my side, and this is about a simple demo about what we are going to cover in AWS automation, and in general how to cover Python code to do your required tasks. So this is all about from my side. If you have any queries, please let me know. And from tomorrow onwards, we are going to start our first class. In case if you are interested, you can log in, you can join with the same link. And see, up to 4 classes we are going to provide free, because you need to know how we are going to teach. After 4 classes, in case if you are if you satisfied with my teaching, then you can continue, but after 4 classes you need to pay the fee. Okay, any queries guys? If you don't have any queries, then